So this is the Goodfriend Memorial Lecture, and many of you probably do not know Marvin Goodfriend. So I wanted to speak, you know, just give a couple of words about him. In order to come up with these words, I did use ChatGPT, and I put Marvin Goodfriend and knowledge creation and diffusion. So to see what in common, you know, this might have. And I got the following. Marvin Goodfriend is an economist who has made significant contributions to the field of monetary economics, particularly in the areas of macroeconomic policy and central banking. He has conducted extensive research on topics such as the role of monetary policy in stabilizing the economy, the effectiveness of unconventional monetary policies, and the design of central bank operating procedures. Then, in terms of knowledge creation, Goodfriend has contributed to the development of new economic models and theories through his research, which has been published in a number of academic journals. He has also co-authored several books, etc. In terms of knowledge diffusion, Goodfriend has been an influential figure in the economics community. He has taught at several universities, including Carnegie Mellon, and has mentored numerous students. He has also served as a visiting scholar at central banks around the world, including the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond, European Central Bank, and others. So that's my summary in the connection to knowledge creation and diffusion. I couldn't find any papers, but you know. All right. So with that said, this is a paper joint with Liyan Shi that some of you might have seen. She came a couple of these core weeks ago. And it's a step back in some ways relative to the previous paper that sort of examined channels of diffusion through knowledge spillovers across people and try to measure those. In the sense that I'm going back to the sort of models where knowledge spillovers are modeled a little bit more in abstract without really relating to the links. but I'm going to try to bring in a consideration that has not been brought into those models, which is the idea of, you know, we do have some intellectual patent, intellectual protection systems. And so try to see whether through the lens of these models, we can say something about the design of these intellectual protections and its implications for knowledge diffusion and innovation. So that question is, how do intellectual property rights affect growth? That's going to be one of the questions that I'm going to answer within the context of these models. And second, how strong should they be? As is usual, you know, when you write a model, the model has a lot of specifics, and you model in a certain way, and at the end, you might come up with answers to the questions that might be less, more or less convincing, but along the way, you learn things, and I think that's the stage of what we are in right now. I mean, I'm going to convey a little bit more about what we learned than, you know, put my finger on, you know, the results that we have right now. Okay, so basically, we're going to be looking at a model where there's going to be, you know, firms that are going to be innovating, firms that are going to be trying to learn from other firms, and these are going to be exclusive activities. And then we're going to follow the literature in that sense. And what we're going to be looking at is how these sort of property rights might affect both the incentives to innovate and the incentives to sort of copy or learn from others. Okay. And so there's two margins. You know, there's on the one margin, you know, if you consider the innovation versus imitation, free riding another's innovation reduces the incentive to innovate. So if I can free ride another's, why should I innovate? And the other is when learning has a cost. So if it's costly to go and learn, there might be a holdup in teaching somebody or having this knowledge transmission might entail a very high tax to imitators or learners. So the model will have a little bit of those two features. And I'm going to take a standard sort of model of diffusion. I'm going to build on Perla Antonetti's model. And basically, what we're going to add is two things. In those models, you know, when you learn, you basically, just copy what others are doing. And there's no transfer. There's not, that surplus that is generated for you. It's kept fully by the person that is learning. The innovator, it does not appropriate any part of the surplus. One of the things that we're going to do is we're going to introduce a sort of Nash barring or somehow a notion of patent strength that will affect the surplus division. And so when a Gray comes and wants, or I come and want to learn something from Gray, he can says, no way, I'm not going to teach you. And sort of he can basically not allow me not to learn or not to participate. And though that leads to a bargaining problem, and so the kind of question that, behind the mind we're looking at is, how does the split of the surplus and that bargaining problem affect these two margins, the margin of diffusion and the margin of innovation? Second part that we're going to add to that literature is that we're going to have congestion knowledge diffusion. And I'm going to step back right now and explain a little bit better later why we want congestion and why it plays a key role in this setting. And so we're going to look at two things. Present you the model, and then we're going to ask two questions of the model. One is long-run growth. So what are implications of different strengths of if you want protection, intellectual protection, on long-run growth? And the second one will be a Ramsey, steps that we have done in solving for a Ramsey problem, which is sort of the optimal property rights, okay, in a calibrated model. So there's a big literature, that we build on. There's a Perla Antonetti is one of the key papers that we're building on. There's a Boyan and Shu have a paper that is sort of related also to ours, and they're looking at the role of licensing in a sort of repeated innovation and diffusion model. And Ufuk has, done papers on thinking about, also how knowledge is diffused in the economies through the sales of patents and so on. And then I'm going to rely on this paper by Garcia Macia Cieclino, which is a paper that sort of tried to decompose the different sources of growth, and I'm going to use that for the purpose of calibration. So that's it. And then, other papers there I didn't mention, but they're really important too. Okay. So we're going to start with an illustrative model, sort of a very simple model, like a one-period model if you want, not even two periods. And to illustrate the mechanisms that are behind. Then I'm going to a dynamic model in this endogenous growth framework, Perla Antonetti, talk about calibration, long-run growth, and the optimal policies. Okay, here's the illustrative model. So basically, think about this as an endowment economy. There's a unit mass of firms. They're endowed with this, call it productivity Z, distributed with this distribution F. And they can improve the productive capacity through innovation or imitation. So firms can either choose to be an innovator or what we're going to call an imitator. If they decide to be an innovation, firms will decide whether to innovate and how much to innovate. And innovators and imitators later, so we're going to have two stages, even one period. First, the innovators will decide how to innovate. And then the second stage will be a matching between those that did not innovate, the imitators, if you want to call it, and the innovators in which the learning process will be mediated. So innovation will create, basically, mu is going to be the parameter that defines the level of innovation, the cost of that innovation. We're going to scale everything up by the initial knowledge that the firm comes within, so that at the end of the day, we're going to get things being invariant to this productivity, all firms are going to choose the same level of innovation. So think about here a fraction alpha will innovate in an allocation or in the equilibrium. This fraction alpha obviously will be selected in the sense that the firms that have higher values of productivity, higher Z, will be innovating and the other ones will not. So diffusion takes place in the following way. There's a matching function. So the matching function, it's going to be a standard constant return to scale matching function. For example, this could be a Cobb-Douglas matching function where alpha is the fraction of innovators, right? And 1 minus alpha is the remaining fraction, which are the ones that be imitating. So there is congestion in this matching process, and I'll describe it a little bit later why it is sort of critical for the questions that we're asking. So lambda of alpha is going to be the contact rate for innovators. That's going to play a role, an important role in calculation. Iota of alpha is going to be that for imitators. Iota for imitators. We didn't have more than one I, so we kept lambda for innovators. So the surplus of the, the surplus to be divided between the firms is basically the assumption here is that the imitator gives up on the possibility of producing unless he learns from somebody. So the surplus for the imitator is basically he learns completely and is able to replicate what the innovator does. And so the flow of payoffs that the imitator will get is mu times c. And that's going to be the total surplus because otherwise it gets zero. And the innovator bargaining weight will be beta, which is the fraction of that surplus that the innovator would get in this bargaining Nash bargaining arrangement. So let me do a short deviation because this is going to be important later on. And this is sort of, I'm going to give you a very simple micro foundation for that bargaining weight through and link it to what we might think of the strength of IP protection. So here is this very simple enforcement game that occurs once the two meet, which is that let's say the innovator will make it a take or leave it offer of a license that you need, the imitator needs to pay in order to be able to do it legally. The imitator either rejects to do that and just copies and take a risk, and with probability beta, it's going to be caught and basically not let produce. Right, so beta here now would represent the probability that this sort of patent being enforced and the innovator being kicked out if he didn't pay the license. Okay, so that's basically, and if it's caught, cannot use the knowledge, product output is zero. I'm going to make the story short. I'm not going to get you go through this. What this implies is a transfer, which is essentially beta times S. And so this justifies this parameter beta here translates into the Nash bargaining power of the innovator. And 1 minus beta is what the imitator gets to keep. All right, so what's the innovator's problem now? The innovator will basically will get an output, mu times z. Okay, that will be the output, mu times z. It gets that for itself for sure. And with probably lambda of alpha, which is a contact rate for innovators, will meet an imitator and will get beta of that surplus, which is mu times C also. What is the cost of innovation will be C mu, also scaled by C. So this gives us the total innovator's surplus. And so the problem of the innovator is maximizing mu. That's a simple first order condition. It's kind of marginal cost is equal to marginal return. And then we have the other problem defining which is the indifference firm. The ones that are above z lower bar will be innovators. The ones below are going to be imitators. For the innovators, the surplus is the one that I just gave you, which is the total surplus that they get from both using their own knowledge and also licensing it. For the on the side of innovators, imitators. Their contact rate, that is their probability of meeting an innovator, is going to be iota of alpha. And in that case, they get the 1 minus beta of a surplus. And since it's random meeting, random matching, the expected surplus is the expectation of all z's that are above this threshold. Okay, so that's basically the equilibrium. And alpha here is going to be the share of the share of the firms that decide to innovate to begin with. Okay. That's all the model. That's all the story. I mean, I was going to say that, I liked your remark that saying, I have a model that fits in one page. And I wanted to say, I have a model that fits in all the pages, So you're going to see equations throughout, All right. So what's the planner's problem here? So what the planner will do is the planner will choose, I'm going to write it this way. Indirectly, the planner is choosing, there's one parameter only the planner controls, which is beta. It's the strength of this patent protection. I'm going to write it this way indirectly through the constraints. Alpha and mu are going to be tied to beta, but it's just more convenient to think of it this way. And so there's the output from the incumbents on the one side. There is then the output, the surplus from matching, which is just the total number of matches that take place multiplied by the expected return of these matches, the expected surplus of each of those matches. So the planner maximizes this subject to the conditions 1 and 2 and implementing this allocation with a choice of a particular beta. Okay? So the mu's and the alphas and mu's are not independent, because at the end they are implemented only by one policy, which is beta. Right, so this is a key slide. In basically, I just rewrote this here. And the first order conditions from this problem, and I don't want you to kind of think through the first order conditions, but the first order conditions have three components. The first component, which I call congestion, is a component that appears in all matching models, in all search random matching models. It is known as kind of the Hosius, I'm going to call it the Hosius term for those of you that are familiar with that. And basically, if that were the only term, which is it captures the congestion, just basically there's an externality. If I am an innovator, I'm displacing, you know, part of the returns I'm getting is displacing other innovators, and I'm giving a positive return to more imitators. And so there are these externalities that are balanced out in the Hosius condition when beta is equal to omega. Omega was the elasticity of the matching function with respect to innovators. Okay, so basically this would tell you if there were no other effects, you would want, you know, the Hosius condition to hold. Then we'll get into that later in our quantitative section. The second effect is what we call a displacement externality, which is basically the following idea. If I'm a marginal innovator and I am there, right? If I join the set of innovators, I'm thinking, you know, do I join or not? I join the set of innovators. I am, in some ways, making the distribution of potential matches worse for the imitators. And so what am I doing is essentially I'm displacing, to some extent, with, you know, me being there, I'm displacing an average innovator. So it's the calculation of this distortion is the mean versus the marginal. And this is really important, right? Instead of meeting a randomly chosen innovator, you're going to meet me that I'm the marginal one. And so that's going to provide a loss for the point of view imitators and a social loss, which will be measured by mean versus margin. Okay, so of course, this is going to be related in some ways to the dispersion of the distribution. And that's going to play an important role in determining this. And the last one is that, you know, by changing sort of this share of innovators, that's going to indirectly, because that's going to imply that you need to change the beta in order to induce that, that's going to have an impact on innovation. So that's going to have an effect on innovation. And this is what we call the innovation spillover. So the effect of, you know, putting more people on one side, it will cost you potentially, or cost you or give you a benefit of more or less innovation. Okay, and that's there. Don't worry about this term yet. I mean, it's essentially, in some ways, part of that is internalized. When a firm decides to innovate, it's doing it to maximize the returns it gets. So the real externality is not what that firm gets, but what the other party will get, which is, in this case, what the innovators that face that firm will get. Okay, so that's the Okay, so
Hugo,
can
I ask a quick question? So when I try to imitate and I get caught, or how was it happening? So if I get caught, I pay punishment, or I'm just not allowed to copy. So what was the beta?
You're out. You're out.
Okay.
Later on, I mean, what we're going to, in the dynamic model, you're not going to be allowed to use that, you know, that idea, and so you can keep searching for ideas, okay?
You will just prevent me from using it.
Yeah.
There's no additional cost.
No, there's no additional cost. There could be. I agree. I mean, there could be. I'm looking at a very limited set of instruments here. I mean, I have only one instrument, and in some ways, I want to implement more than one thing because I would want to implement innovation levels, and I want to implement sort of the right fraction of innovators and imitators. That's a game we're playing. We're playing, you know, this is not about optimal policies unrestricted, but it's in terms of this particular instrument, which we call patent policy and enforcement policy, and thinking about what's the optimal of that. Yes.
The imitators have no productive value, right? They only act to steal, but you still want them around. Like, why?
They're valuable because they contribute to learning, right? I mean, they will contribute eventually if they learn. They once they learn, they have productive value. Okay, so
why not the planner choosing meal set by set? So I mean, the productive guy, I can be assigning higher meal, innovate more for the
because planner. The planner has, as I just said,
for the planner,
has only one instrument, which is the patent strength. That's it, and not selectively different patent strengths for different firms.
Would the implication be different if my monopoly right over my idea expires with some probability?
Yeah, I mean, that it could be. I mean, that could be easily introduced. I mean, that's going to reduce the claim over value that, you know, the innovator will have, the claim over its innovation value. So it might to some extent be, I think it's in some ways it's going to be similar to the effect of changing beta. Right? I mean, if you think about beta representing some of the expected discounted time, which the duration of the patent will go. But this is just from the back of my head. No, nothing. No, don't put a lot of weight on that. Okay, so here are some functional forms. So we're gonna let's say you have a Pareto distribution for this productivity. Matching function, which we're going to use also in the dynamic model, is the Cobb-Douglas omega. Here's the elasticity, that relevant elasticity, and then a cost function, which is I think we've seen this before, like homogeneous cost function, where basically the term epsilon dictates the elasticity of the cost with respect to mu. It's kind of an important parameter there, right? So this is just an example, but later I'm going to use this in the quantitative model. So think about, this parameter, Pareto parameter, is goes from, high to low here. High means, 20 means essentially all the firms are the same. So there's no heterogeneity. There's still, even though there's no heterogeneity, a fraction of the firms will innovate, a fraction will, and that's efficient. You don't want everybody to innovate because there is this alternative of being able to learn from others too. And so, as we go to, one would be the, more dispersed. And so if you recall from what we said before, the mean versus marginal is going to change as we go in that direction. So you can see here the sort of the mean versus marginal goes, let's say, from 1 to 11 in these, with these examples. So the Hosius condition, because we're going to assume omega is equal to 0.5, so this elasticity would say beta should be equal to 0.5. If we go back here and take these two conditions and set those equal to zero, so the Hosius and the displacement, and of the displacement, that would lower beta to 0.28. So you want to discourage crappy innovators from being there, right? So it's a selection effect. And then once you bring in that, the spillover effect, so if you put the three effects together, so to induce more innovation, then you increase a little bit beta. So you want property rights to be a little bit stronger to induce more innovation. So this is kind of the result. I mean, and this is a result that we're going to see, consistently when we look at the planner's problem in the Ramsey problem. In this particular example, if you were looking only at spillover, you want to maximize the innovation rate. It actually happens that it's the same as the Hosius condition, would be 0.5. And in the absence of heterogeneity is 0.5. And that, magically coincide there. All right, so let me now go to the dynamic model. So I lay out the kind of the basics, the basic ingredients. We have this sort of, on the one hand, innovation. We have learning from others through matching. Oh, I should have said, I'm going to say this in words because I should have said this. Why do we care about congestion? And why do we have congestion in this exercise? A lot of the literature doesn't have congestion. Basically, if I want to learn, I'm not affected by how many people are there out there to teach me. So basically the probability of meeting someone in all these diffusion models is exogenous, it's independent of how many people are on the other side. Well, that would make the result very trivial. What you want is just the most productive firm be the only one to innovate and all the rest to learn from that one, right? And so that trivializes the problem. And so, we think congestion is a reasonable thing, and that's why sort of we brought it in the picture. So the general model, I mean, it borrows a lot of features of the some of the models that you've seen before. Think about this as a monopolistic This is an aggregator. You can think of a monopolistic competition setting. In the log utility intertemporally. And then in terms of production, so there were going to be what we call active firms and inactive. The active firms are going to be the ones that are doing both two things at the same time. They're going to be producing and innovating. The inactive firms, think about those of entrance. They're there. They're out of the industry, and they're just looking for ideas. And once they find one, they're going to enter and produce and also innovate as they're there. So the production function for the incumbent firms is linear. Again, L is labor. And then this is a sort of basically, this is just the way we're phrasing this is, think about this as being a manager. C of U is the time the manager devotes to innovating. The rest of the time devotes to producing. And so one minus that is the time allocated to production, and that production will be proportional to that human capital input, to the managerial input. So basically, the costs are, this is convenient, are scaled to be in terms of the, your final good, and they're proportional also in that way to your productivity. Okay, the productivity is Z. We're going to assume sort of Z is log normal. That's we have E of Z in here. And I guess that's it. No, I mean, this from this. All right. So the inactive firms try to find ideas. Alpha T, again, denotes the set, the mass of active firms. And we're going to assume there's a mass one of firms. And so alpha T is the rate of those firms, the ones that are producing and innovating. One minus alpha T are the set of, if you want, potential entrants that are looking for ideas.
Hugo?
Yes.
Maybe I should have asked this before, and it's related to this alpha. Is there, there's going to be a Z threshold for who innovates.
Yeah.
That's how And then in the previous table that you showed for the other model, was that there in the table?
Yeah. It was identical in that sense. Alpha was the fraction of the firms above that Z lower bar.
So implicit in that alpha, there is a Z threshold.
Implicit in the alpha is exactly, it is a Z conditional on the existing distribution productivities, which evolves over time. So it's endogenous. Indeed, in this dynamic model, will be endogenous. Okay. All right, so in terms of the productivity process, it's going to be a Brownian motion. And mu is the drift of the Brownian motion. So that what firms are choosing are the drift of the Brownian motion. And there's going to be volatility sigma. So the volatility sigma, by the way, this is related to a work that Sam has done too. I mean, in terms of when I talk about diffusion and early work from Sam. And what this is, volatility will play an important role because it's kind of going to tell you something about randomness, and it's going to be very relevant in determining the overall dispersion in the distribution of existing firms' productivity. So we're going to see that is going to play an important role here. All right, so when the imitator meets an innovator, it draws a random quality. So we're going to allow for imperfect imitation, right? So it's going to run a random quality, and actually it could be imperfect up or down. Our calibration will tend to move it down, and the average of an imitator will be 30% of the existing innovator, yeah? We're gonna introduce something that, creative destruction. Since I know Ufuk was gonna be here, I had to have creative destruction, right? But we're gonna put it under the rug a little bit in the following way. So when an imitator learns something, we can define two possible states. It could be a completely new product that is not competing with the product that was offered by the existing firm that they learned from. Or with probability delta, it actually, if it's better than the product of the existing firm, so remember, because there is this incomplete learning potentially, if it's better, then it's going to displace that firm. Okay, so that's kind of our way of putting creative destruction. Yes, you
Yeah, so I have a question. So Here, imitators or inactive firms are learning from innovators. And what about, like, usually we think about the spillovers of innovation within, between innovators. Yeah. Like, what about spillover from innovation, which would affect, in a way, that logic, which I really like, this fact that inframarginal versus average. There you may think that now this marginal guy is entering and really like approaches the problem solution in a very different way. So there is a value for other innovators in learning something.
Yeah, I mean, we have a one-dimensional thing here, which is the, you know, just the level of knowledge. And as, you know, following those models, we assume that, you know, knowledge, learning something that you already know, I mean, is not useless. It's useless for a firm. But no, definitely, I mean, this is taking, and this is a little bit literature driven, I should say, in that, you know, in Perlin and Tonetti, there were these, in some ways, the cost of not being, the cost of being an imitator is that you give up the possibilities of producing and innovating. I mean, I think if I would have called this exit, nobody would have had a question about that. And then, you know, there are a lot of these models where Ludmer has a model where, you know, firms, when they enter, they learn kind of, their initial shock is kind of a random draw from the distribution of. But yes, I mean, I agree there is that margin, and, you know, it's important, it's not here. Okay. All right, so now what's going to be the, when will the creative destruction take place? It will take place when, not only when, you know, this is a potential creative destruction, it has to be enough, sufficiently good to be better than the previous one. That, remember, will occur with this thing we call delta hat. And remember, delta hat is the probability then that in when a match between an innovator and an imitator takes place, that imitator will creatively destroy and will, so it will, rather than, you know, add a new product with the value, you know, that it gets, it's gonna add that new product, but at the same time, it will displace the existing one. Okay, so that's a, that's all. Okay, so the reason we have this is also to have a close mapping, what we're going to use for calibration, which is this paper by Garcia Marcia, Cieganclino, where they try to sort of, you might question their identification criteria. We're using this for now, but, you know, we don't have another, maybe you could suggest a better alternative, but we're using this that will separate the sources of growth into the growth that is from innovators, from innovation of incumbents or from incumbents, and the growth from entrants that could come from two parts, from creative destruction or a new product variety. So basically, you know, that's the idea. Okay, so I think I'm gonna have to skip a little bit these value functions, but the value functions sort of have, sort of a key term is an analog to what we had before in terms of the surplus created. This is the surplus of a match, which is basically conditional on the match being successful in the sense that you get a draw that is worthwhile. It's the value of the draw for the new firm minus W here represents the value it had, the outside value it has. So W is the value you have if you continue being an imitator, you're outside, you know, you're not producing. And so the net gain is the surplus that is generated by this match. Right? And so there is, it's going to be a split with, you know, beta of this net gain with the game I told you before will be obtained by the incumbent firm. One minus beta will be retained by the innovator. So that would be, sorry, the imitator. That would be the licensing. But on top of that, when you look at the value function, so if you think about the value function of the innovator, it has all the terms that you would expect here from purely, you know, the profit flow of the firm, and then, you know, the terms that are determined by the random, the Brownian motion. And then the new terms are, upon meeting in a match, it gets beta of that surplus that I explained before, but with probability delta hat, it gets destroyed. And so it goes from, it loses the value it has now, it's thrown back to the pool of imitators, or it's out of the industry, it gets WT. Yeah.
Sorry, Well, I just want to ask, so could you think of intellectual property protection as also something that allows the firms to not get creatively destroyed? Maybe I don't want to share. Like, if my beta is high, I choose not to share. I don't care how much of the surplus you give.
In fact, so given our choices, you would, given this enforcement problem, if you interpreted this enforcement game, you would never want not to be kicked out. Because the transfer that you receive is actually, you would always accept the license as opposed to having the risk, leaving the person with the risk of kicking you out. And if you could have, different, that policies would be the strength of patent, maybe this is what you're trying to say, the strength of protection being more directed towards that would make sense. I mean, in fact, a lot of the way this works is, you prosecute, you go to prosecuting, and maybe the incentives for prosecution are bigger if you are being destroyed than not, and so enforcement could be bigger then. We don't have that here, okay? But that's we didn't have this delta before, but we thought it would be better, to match the data with creative destruction. Okay, so we're going to be looking at a balanced growth path. So, and this is basically sort of a slide explaining the different sources of growth, and this is what's going to allow us to go, and match and sort of calibrate the model to the data. So the first source is own innovation. Obviously, there is the drift mu of the firms. There's also this term, this unfortunate term, for those of you familiar, it enters. We don't kill the variance in the drift, and it appears sort of confounded here. But this is own innovation. Creative destruction is basically the, in some ways, this reflects mean versus marginal, so the level of creative destruction. And then there's new varieties, minus exit. So creative destruction basically generates a gain, which is the draw, the improvement over the existing product. That would be this draw Q. So this would be the delta and the models of like Clair and Cortum, and minus one because you're basically displacing this firm. And this one doesn't have that minus one. This is a contribution of new varieties. This is a contribution of exit. The firms that are at the threshold exit, and the relative importance of those firms depends on what that threshold is relative to the mean. Okay, so that's a negative effect on exit. Okay. So the tail of it, so this is going to generate an endogenous distribution in a steady state. The only thing I want to highlight is the tail of the distribution. It's going to have a Pareto tail. It's going to be affected by volatility, as I mentioned before. So higher volatility will lead to longer tails. Diffusion is a source of mean reversion. So when other firms learn, they're kind of catching up. And so that's mean reversion. And so mean reversion acts in the opposite way. It sort of tends to thin the Pareto tail. So when we see mean reversion here, it's more mean reversion will mean thinner tails. More volatility in innovation will mean thicker tails. That's all what I want to say there. So calibration, these are described the first two before. These are parametric forms we pick. G is going to be an exponential distribution. We calibrate the existing level of beta. It's going to be like 0.5. This reflects the fact that licensing royalty rates tend to be about 10% of revenues, and revenues are like 20%, profits are 20% of revenues, and so that makes it like 50% of profits. Okay, so that's what we lose. For calibrating these parameters, own innovation is 1.15%. We still need to separate, this between these two. The own variance, this is from the, again, this paper by Garcia Masia St. Clino, is calibrated to sigma 0.11, and so on. Let's see. Creative destruction, this is again comes from the contribution of creative destruction The incidence of creative destruction for entrants is 5.4%. That determines this term here. The average quality of in creative destruction, again, this comes from the contribution to growth in this paper, is 1.26. So those give us, you know, this full term of creative destruction that with a contribution of 0.46% to growth. And finally, new varieties, again, you know, taking a similar approach, looking at the entrants and new varieties that are creating by entrants, and the average quality is give us a contribution. Oh, by the way, exit is almost null. It doesn't, I mean, quantitatively, it doesn't have any effect. So this is the calibration is meant to match then, again, this growth decomposition in García Macia C. Inclino, so GHK. All right, so I have like 4 minutes left. Well, I took 2 minutes. I have 5 minutes left. I have six. Okay, fine. All right, so here are some of the results. So the first I'm going to tell you about the results of growth, and so of long-run growth, and how it changes with beta, and then I'm going to talk about our exercise of Ramsey, solving the Ramsey problem. So this is sort of total growth, and what you can see is that it increases with beta, so long-run growth is increasing in beta. There's two effects. One is this is the own innovation of firms that's increasing in beta. And so the more property rights they have, the you know more innovation they get. And total growth is increasing in beta. There's very little effect on diffusion. And so it doesn't affect too negatively diffusion. You might think, and this is true in an extreme, if beta is equal to one, so that the imitators get nothing, you would have no imitators and no diffusion. And that's true, but there's a discontinuity at beta equal to one. And what happens is that there's these force, well, maybe I'm gonna tell it later. I mean, there is a reason in the model. If you're interested in these nerdy things as I am, you know, I'll tell you what they are. Okay, so I'm gonna skip. So this is important, which is, traces a little bit that connects to what we saw in the first place, which is as beta decreases, what we get is that the innovator contact rate decreases, and the mean, as beta increases, the mean to margin ratio increases. I don't know, I'm not gonna go through this slide because it's not, this is part of that nerdy, it's okay, optimal policy. So what we're solving is a Ramsey problem. We're maximizing the present discounted value of the utility by picking a process for betas subject to basically that you're generating, given those betas, your sequence of betas, you're generating an equilibrium and that evolves over time. And what we're characterizing in this and similar to what you know, they do in optimal taxation, where they're looking at the limited you know, tax on capital, we're looking at the tail of that beta distribution, and it converges, and so also the process converges to a balanced growth path in the limit. And so that's what we're characterizing here. But even though we're characterizing here, that doesn't mean that we're putting all the weight on long-run growth. We're really thinking about you know, how you know, the planner wants to choose his betas, and also thinking at that point, you know, putting a discounting future and you know. So it's different from long growth maximizing. And so the optimal beta has the three effects that we had before. It has that congestion effect, it has the displacement externality effect, and it has the growth effect. They're obviously more complicated through the lens of this model, but the three effects are there, the same three effects. And here are the results. So this is kind of the final, this is my final sort of final slide. We're calibrating, this is the calibration that we have. The optimal beta is actually, the enforcement probability is actually zero. So it's at the corner. And the reason for this is, intuitive reason for this is, we're trying to match the data on the distribution of firms' productivities, which is sort of the distribution of firm sizes. What do we know about that? That the tail of the distribution, it's a sort of looks like a Pareto distribution, it's very very long tail. What does that mean? That mean to marginal is fairly high. And so mean to marginal is bad here. The planner wants to discourage the participation of very marginal firms. And so if mean to marginal is very large, it will try to compress and have less firms participating. And so that pushes the claims of the incumbent firms, it pushes them down to zero. And in fact, that's all what the optimal is. Let firms just get the returns to innovation that they get for their own sake. No returns from innovation that they get from transferring knowledge to others. Okay. All right. And that's basically what we have. And so let me just conclude with this slide. It's okay if I go through a conclusion slide. Okay. So basically, all right. It's my conference. Let me go back to a couple of slides. Yeah, you know, I thought, it's my conference. And I said, I have to present. I shouldn't have invited such good people. No? I mean, they make me look bad. No? All right, so the paper considered this, heterogeneity of growth through knowledge diffusion and sentence for imitation and imitation innovation. I talked about the hostess condition as sort of a benchmark to think about the congestion. But in the model, I mean, the externalities that are called like displacement externalities kind of play a really important role. And in fact, we get that this optimal betas, optimal share, that a surplus that innovators should get, it's very little. Oh, by the way, I should say something that's important. In the Ramsey problem that we solve, we have not been able to solve yet the problem with endogenous innovation. So what we're solving is exogenous innovation. So it's basically dictated then by, rather than all the effects, by the two first effects. Yeah. We expect that once we are able to solve with innovation, that's going to bring up a little bit the beta, but we're not there yet. Okay. And what is the plan now?